actually not on the check on the budget, but we have been benefited. He does not even have a report for the October meeting, so after 6 months, we just get a report on the introduction of universal credit.
Is that up to the side?
It's outside.
Moving on to business planning, section 1915, section 1922.
Dealing with this has been on the table for two
for many, 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 many years. My concern is that it's not done strategically, that you get bits coming to P&R, bits might go to housing, bits might go to asset regeneration. Is it a time for us to be set up as a separate strategic committee that deals with Great Cross Brookwood? You're talking about the station, it's interesting how it would be. Somebody who works at Great Cross for two different anchor stores either end of it, I know the area. Just have a proper strategic committee that's bringing in, because there's going to be transport issues, there's going to be street scene issues, open space issues, health, education, provision. I'm just thinking, you know, the last 4 years when this has come up, it's been frustrating for councillors and local residents. It's not, there doesn't seem to be any overarching strategic plan or a committee that deals with it. And I just think going to different committees, I think this is a massive opportunity to show that we can work together to get something amazing. One of the biggest projects in London for the last 20, 30 years outside of the East London area. So, we've got to get it right. But if we don't get it right, we'll look foolish and we're missing a massive opportunity to deal with more people. And I think we also need to deal with on the border with Brent and Camden. We need to be working with those local authorities as well. I just think this is a committee to say, make a decision. Actually, this needs to be a separate committee that does break across the
country. This has been done, hasn't it? There has been a shareholders committee with Labour members on it as well, when they have been looking at this in great detail.
I think it just needs to be, we as a council need to set up a separate committee that deals with that person.
Yeah, I think, to be fair, the shareholders is only Brent Cross South, it's not the whole project.
Yes, okay. Well, I mean, maybe it is time then that we should actually, at some stage later this year, have a complete refresh. But I'm slightly chary about another committee, if I think we could have a report.
I sat on the committee structure, so well, we have committees every single month that we got things done. But okay. If you want things done, you know.
Okay. I'm taking the point.
As a newcomer to PR, I don't need a substitute, but as a substitute for the chair of Barnes and as the chair of housing. I think that what Councillor Gerd is describing is very similar to what we are actually doing in practice with ARC. A lot of councils would have a single committee for both what ARC covers and what housing covers. It's partly because there is so much redevelopment going on in the borough that we took the decision to split them into 4 years ago. I think we're no doubt that the primary committee for council overseeing the development of Red Cross is ARC. It gets a report on that every single meeting, and housing is essentially subsidiary to that. And we have the chairs of each committee sitting on the other committee. So the two committees I'm talking about housing are very linked. And of course, those things should then be referred up to P&R as well. But I think that's a perfectly rational structure for Red Cross. And the progress on site is actually happening, and you know there are many complicated pieces of the jigsaw, but it is definitely moving forward.
Thank you. We're moving on to my second area, these two pages over on page 35, the strategic response. I don't particularly have some concerns that there might be a bit of model thinking in terms of 1.5.14 and the five key strands, which talks about number one being growth and development and two being managing demand. For number one to happen, I'm sure you would agree that there will be a knock-on impact on demand for council services and demand for council expenditures and things like that. So, how are you proposing to manage between the two? You're not in Tom Davies' wet dream. You're not going to get these magic council taxpayers who don't use any council services. That's just not going to happen. It's a feature of any form of development. It's very clear from development that we have had. Is that many people who live on regeneration estates and new growth areas, they also have demands for council services. So how do you propose both.
Because the tax revenues will follow the people as they arrive here, and government grants, and when they are distributed are based on that. And quite a lot of things that that are funded for newcomers do not fall under the levies of this council, but are instead funded by the government. I think particularly of health and education.
I understand. I think there are particular areas though, where actually we are somewhat creating a role for our impact. So for example, with the environment and waste services, we may well magically somehow increase our recycling rates, but the tonnage of, with the very substantial increase in the population of the borough, the waste tonnage figures are going to go up, and that will have a knock-on impact, particularly if we are to make some of the council does decide to make some of these decisions, like not doing food recycling, etc., and removing some of the recycling. So I wonder to what extent we've got proper joined-up thinking in ensuring that the growth and development of the borough actually matches what ends up happening with the delivery of services.